This is The Pulse, and on The Pulse today we begin. All is set for the campaign launch of the National Democratic Congress campaign launch in the Central Region on Sunday. According to the General Secretary of the party, who was on the AM show today, all the necessary arrangements have been made for a successful event. We can listen to him.
We've done so well in all those indicators, and the purpose of Sunday's launch will not be so much about our achievements and where we are going to go from there. We're going to launch the campaign, introduce our candidates, and then indicate how the campaign will go, the nature of our campaign, and so on. And then 2 or 3 weeks from there, we will now launch our manifesto, as we have always done. When you lump all the activities together, you don't get the space to deal with each of them sufficiently. So from 2004, we've always introduced our presidential ticket on a different date. And then we will do our campaign launch, and then we will do our manifesto launch. And we have followed that tradition to date. This time around, we are going to put together the introduction of our presidential ticket together with the campaign launch. And then we will reserve the manifesto launch for another time and another venue.
That'll be from what time from now? Or from the launch
of
the campaign?
We originally projected 2 weeks after the campaign launch. But things have changed a little because we were all heading towards November 7th. So now we have the luxury to, if you are like, add a few more days and plan the campaign, the manifesto launch better. It's likely to be in somewhere in the middle belt, either Kumasi or Sunyane.
When?
Well, I thought I've just answered that question.
No, you said 2 weeks after campaign.
I said that that was the original plan, 2 weeks after the campaign launch. But because we now have another month added to the election calendar, we will have the freedom to, you know, extend it.
This is The Pulse, and joining me in the studio is Malik Dabo from our political desk for more analysis on this. Before then, let's go on to the phone lines and speak with political science lecturer from the University of Ghana. Well, I'm told our lines are not misbehaving. We'll get him back on the line. Malik Dabo is here. Hello, Malik. Let me gather your thoughts on this launch of campaign that looks like it's going to be massive for the NDC.
Of course, I mean, it will be massive. This is a governing party, and you know that the NDC has done this over and over again, and we know that the president has been embarking on some tours, but the party itself hasn't engaged in any political campaign activity. I think that this event will be used to galvanize, mobilize the party's people, get all the key persons in the party, give them some rules. They will tell us who is doing what. We know that they've given us some indication of who is going to speak for the party. Kofi Adams is campaign coordinator. Joyce Bauer speaks for the president in the campaign. I'm sure that a lot more names will come up, especially in terms of regional coordinators of the party's campaign. And I'm sure all of those people will be they'll be unveiled at this program. So I'm expecting a very well organized, because this is the governing party, they have all the resources that they need, and their grassroots are excited about this, because of course this is an election they want to win. So all of them, they will mobilize all the people to this event. I'm sure we'll get a great event.
We'll get a great event, but let's look at the event itself. What are your expectations, at the event?
Well, my expectations are basically that we will hear speeches, we will hear political rhetoric, we will hear the president talk about the things that he has done before and why he deserves a second term and a third term for the NDC. That's what we will hear. And I think we will hear opportunities given to regional coordinators to speak so that people can be heard. Because this is a campaign launch, We will have representations from the various regions and the various constituencies from across the country gathering in Cape Coast. All of these persons, when they come, they expect to hear their representatives speak to them. I'm expecting that we will have all of these people speak, and we will get key information from the president, key ministers, who will tell us what is happening, regional ministers who will tell us what they have done. I expect that it will be a well-coordinated event.
Do you, I mean, in some of the campaigns, let's say 2012 campaign, we saw some responses to some of the issues raised by their political opponents. Should we expect something like that, since the general secretary of the party says they are not perturbed by things that people say, especially a recent survey by the CDD? Should we expect such responses at the event?
They certainly will. Because remember that I just pointed out, the party faithful are going to gather here. What the party leadership and the government will be seeking to do will be to tell them that, look, don't be daunted at all about this survey result. Just be resolved that we have done a lot of work on the ground and that this election we can win if all of you put your wheels to the shoulder. I'm expecting that they will try to, if there are negative stories against the party and government, they will try to assure their people that there's no credence to these stories. Be rest assured, the government has done what it ought to do. The government has solved Ghanaians' problems, is in the process of solving them. The government is laying down a solid foundation for the takeoff of the economy. They will deal with all those things that will hurt the party's campaign. The president, other spokespersons will be seeking to deal with those ones and to answer them. And this heavy resource is one thing that they will respond to, and respond to vigorously. The general secretary we had, Asirin Ketia, tried to dismiss it, and that's what they would do. They would dismiss it and say, look, don't give it any credence. It's not credible. Since 2002, we have distanced ourselves from CDD because we believe that the CDD is politically aligned, i.e. the CDD is made up of adherents of our opponents, and therefore whatever they put out there is seeking to dampen our spirit and to undermine our campaign. Don't listen to them. The grounds show clearly that we will win. Yesterday we heard Communications Minister Omane Boamah speaking in the Eastern region, where he said that all the researches that have been conducted shows that at least in that region they will win 7 more seats and raise their tally to 14. Right. Out of the 33 constituencies in that region, they hold 7. They want to double that figure by winning 7 more and make 14. He says research show that they will win. I believe that this is what they will seek to do. Ignore the CDD research. Our own research point to the fact that we are winning the elections hands down. I believe that's what they will be seeking to tell the party faithful who will gather in Cape Coast.
And after all said and done, will it position the NDC differently?
Well, for the faithful who will come, what they are looking for is a morale booster. Because remember that this is a government that some believe hasn't performed, and in fact some party people are themselves not too sure. So when they meet here and they are told that, look, all is under control, we have the president has worked well, this is appreciated by people across the country, tell the message, tell people that, look, we have done well, it will be a morale booster for many of them. They will be excited to go and do the work, do the legwork that will guarantee them victory.
Malik, we've heard about this argument over who is plagiarizing whose ideas, who is plagiarizing whose manifesto. Now, the MPP accused the NDC. The NDC has also come to accuse the NPP. I mean, this fuss, is it even necessary at this particular time?
Well, it's not. Unfortunately, there is absolutely nothing we can do about it. That the two main political parties will continue to accuse each other of stealing each other's ideas, because as far as they are concerned, they won't have a debate without these accusations, because they believe that these accusations seek to mobilize their people. That, look, the MPP will posture itself as a party with the greatest ideas. The NDC will disagree and say, look, we have the greatest ideas. If you listen to Asirin Ketia this morning, he points out that, look, they are a socialist democratic party. The things that the MPP are promising are things that the socialist democratic party should be doing. So if the MPP is claiming that they are plagiarizing, what in fact is happening, he alleges and claims, is that it's the MPP that is stealing their political philosophical ideas, i.e. health insurance, free education.
Because they are all social policies.
So his argument is these are things that a social democratic party as the NDC should be seeking to do. If you have a national, an MPP, which is a property-owning democracy, because that's what they say they are,
right,
now seeking to do free education and do all of these other things, then you should rather be accused of stealing the ideas of the NDC. Of course, you will have the MPP argue that, look, we said that we're going to do a Northern Development Fund. The NDC poo-pooed it, and later they did a Savannah Accelerated Development Agency.
Which is, in essence,
authority, SADA. Aha. So they argued that, look, we brought this idea, you sold it. We said we would do free education for senior high level. You said it was not possible. You have come back. You are doing it. So you have these computing arguments, claims, and counterclaims. There's absolutely nothing we can do about that. In fact, we have to expect more.
And what does it put on the table of the electorate?
Well, at the end of the day, that's the unfortunate aspect of it. The electorate then become confused, but not too confused, because the electorate know, regardless of what the government is doing, the electorate know that even though it is a constitutional provision that education will be made progressively free, the persons who put education and free education for that matter on the front burner for a national discussion was the MPP and their flag bearer. There's no doubt in anybody's mind about that. So the party that argued that, look, we are going to increase power by 5,000 megawatts of power is the NDC. No matter what the MPP do, the electorate know that this promise was made by the NDC. So while they create a certain level of confusion and sometimes you get bored with the cacophonous noise, but some of the electorate know who is making which promise and who is copying from whom.
And who will deliver. Right.
Absolutely.
So, I think Ketia makes an interesting point. You know, there are some members of the NDC who have been offended one way or the other. I can point Nyama Shite, who lost his case in court, and many others. And some of these people want to go independent. And Asiedu Nketia is quite sure that all of these will not fly.
Well, you wouldn't expect him to say anything else, because he's the general secretary of the governing party. He cannot be seen to be ignominious. He has to promise his people that, look, don't be afraid, don't be worried. All these people who are saying they are disgruntled and that they will contest as independent, we will win. They can't make any impact. You should trust him to say that. Does the evidence support that? Not quite.
Right.
Because there are constituencies where people won by a whisker. So in those constituencies, if you have somebody, a disgruntled person not voting, his supporters alone not going out to vote can cause the party the seat.
But
there's no two ways about that. So we know about Abuga Pele in China Para constituency, for example.
Right.
You just mentioned Nyama Shite for Kloto Kole constituency.
Exactly.
There are many others in some other constituencies. Because of the narrow nature of our campaigns and our electoral results, you can't wish away some of these things. If only 10 people or 15 people refuse to go and vote because they are dissatisfied with the manner in which a certain primary was run, that can cost the party the seat. We have 7 independent parliamentarians in our parliament. If you go and check, all of these people come from the 2 major political parties.
Right.
And they probably would have lost a primary and they decided to contest as independent and then they win. So you can't wish away all of these. But of course, he's a general secretary. You don't expect him to come and say, oh, this will affect us.
But this is a ruling party that seems to be complacent, because you hear the general secretary talk about we don't really care about what people say. We want to set their agenda for ourselves. We want to follow our pace. CDD says 70% of Ghanaians think the country is going the wrong direction. General secretary says we don't mind. Our own research shows that the country is going the right direction. Another research shows that the NDC is the most the political party that uses a lot of violence, or let me say
yes, you are talking about Media Foundation for West Africa's
exactly
finding that
using
in the last month they topped the chart in the use of indecent language
and a whole lot. And NDC says our own research shows that our president is going to win. I mean, EIU also brought a research that says that the MPP will win with a slight margin and all of that. But the NDC is quite sure that their own research says that their candidate is going to be the winner. And all of these doesn't look like it's healthy.
But
for
which
the
is
NDC.
Not surprising, Aisha. It's not surprising because all governing parties tend to be this arrogant, if for want of a better expression. In 2008, we saw the same thing. If you do a research, the MPP will dismiss it because there's something about power. You have power, you have resources. When you are a politician in a predominantly poor country such as ours, the tendency to believe that with sufficient resources, last minute, regardless of the feelings of the people, you can get people and sway them with perks to vote a certain direction is there. And in fact, it does happen. We know that in our politics, during elections, all the political parties go and they try to engineer the process by resourcing people and getting them to vote in a certain way. In some constituencies, it works. Other times, it doesn't work. The governing party has all the resources. So they certainly can't come out and tell anyone that, look, because of all of these findings, we are not doing too well. It would be naive to expect that they would do that. In fact, that expectation would be unreasonable. What we expect them to do...
But it could be a party accepting the reality. That could also fetch you some votes.
Well, but if you notice, apart from what Asidin Ketia has said, yesterday I was listening to some quotes that were attributed to Felix Ofosu-Kwachi, who is a deputy communications minister, and he was pointing out that, well, we have heard the results, we have seen them, we know that there are challenges, we are working to deal with them. Some time back, he would have attacked the credibility and the integrity of the processes that were used in arriving at those conclusions. I have a sense that there's a certain attempt to move away from the grandstanding of dismissing everything and saying, look, we have seen the results, we know the concerns, we are working at dealing with them. But you can't stop the politicians from dismissing these kinds of results. If a result were to come out today to say that the MPP will not win, you should trust that the MPP will come out and dismiss it. And you were just pointing out the findings of the Media Foundation for West Africa's media monitoring. Right. When it doesn't favor the MPP, they come out and dismiss it. It doesn't favor the NDC. You should expect that they will come out and dismiss it. It's expected. It's not surprising at all. But for the governing party, the fundamental point is they have the resources. And when they have the resources, they believe that with those resources and with what the president, the government has done, which they have compiled in the green book and showing to the people what the president has done, they have sufficient belief that they can win. Even if they were to find any survey results that shows that they will not win, and this would have been done by they themselves, they will not come out and tell you, because that would have been to demoralize their own people. So they will have to keep telling their people, assuring them, look, the only way to encourage the people to put up a fight is to tell them that we are winning. To concede that the results is not good for us is to throw up your hands and then give up. No political party would do that.
But indeed, you have power, you have resources. Don't forget, it's the electorates that put you there. This is a party that also preaches to put people first. So in all of these, putting power and resources first and not listening to people who say, 70%, not just a little, 70%, over 50% saying the country is going the wrong direction and you don't listen to the electorates, where do you seek to place the electorates?
Well, they may be listening, except that they will not tell you. They may be listening. They may just take these survey results, and Aisha, let's not kid ourselves. They may take these survey results more seriously than you and I would do. They will take these results, they will go and start looking at those areas that they are not doing too well. By now, they are conducting their own research. They will do a comparative analysis of the outcomes of their own surveys and the outcomes of the CDDs. Now, they will go in and find out which other areas do we need to tweak? Which area should we send what resources? Who should we empower? What should we do where? They will do all of that. When they come out publicly, they will not tell you that they are responding to the survey results, because that will undermine their own standing and that will demoralize their people and deflate their egos. So they will put up a brave face and tell you that, look, all is well,
and be working underground.
Absolutely, and well, they'll be working towards
changing. We hope they do
things.
So, and we wish them all the best on
Absolutely.
Sunday in launching their campaign. Many thanks to you. Malik is on the political desk. Meanwhile, some sympathizers of the National Democratic Congress have paraded the streets of the Volta Regional Capital Hall to show appreciation to the President John Dramani Mahama for his contribution towards the development of the region. According to these supporters, the development environmental projects undertaken by the president in the region have gone a long way to alleviate their plight. A reason for this show of gratitude. Correspondent Fred Kwame Asare was with them earlier. He now joins me via phone. Good evening to you, Fred Kwame Asare. Good evening, Fred Kwame Asare. What more can you tell us about this youth showing gratitude to the president, John Dramani Mahama?
This work was basically organized to show appreciation to President Mahama for allocating numerous projects to the region. This is according to organizers of the work. The work was dubbed Volta Appreciates JM. So participants, of which mainly I should say are sympathizers of the NDC, paraded the street earlier today to sing praises onto President Mahama for bringing so much development projects to the region and then helping improve their livelihood. While the work was ongoing, some participants were distributing flyers of some key projects in the region to onlookers as the work progresses. So I spoke to some of the participants, and then they told me that apart from Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, no other president can match up with President John Mahama when we're talking about development projects. And then they also mentioned the University of Health and Allied Sciences, the whole Central Market Project, the Abatua, the whole airport, the Eastern Corridor Road, among other projects that are being undertaken by the Mahama-led administration. And then also, let me also touch a little bit on turnout. I should say that turnout wasn't really encouraging, where residents in who did not fully partake in the work. Maybe it's because today is a market day, but that notwithstanding, many or a chunk of the participants of this work were passed from neighboring communities like CRV, Klepe, Tokukwe, among others. And let me also say that organizers of this particular work put on record that this work is not related to the NDC, but then to residents of the Volta region, trying to show appreciation and then to say thank you to President Mahama for giving them so many development projects.
Well, many thanks to you, Fred Kwame Asare. We can speak with leader of the supporters, Manfred Nukudei, who joins us also via phone. Good evening to you, Manfred. Thanks for your time on The Pulse.
Good evening. Good evening to your listeners.
Manfred, you talk of development projects being the reason for your parade to show gratitude to the president. Mention some of the developments you've seen that's giving you this high hope to appreciate the president.
Thank you very much. I need not say much because the development projects are there for people to see. But since you are far away in Accra, I will be compelled to mention just a few. The University of Health and Allied Sciences that was started by Professor Mayo has been completed. 2 weeks ago, the first batch of graduates were graduated from that school, from that institution.
Right.
The Pepesu Road, which has been our concern for several years now, that is the Eastern Corridor, part of the Eastern Corridor. When you're driving from KJB to Kwanta, it takes you about 2 hours. Now, if you hold a very good car, in the next 40 minutes, you are in KJB, you are in Kwanta, and it's marvelous. I don't want to go too far. I'll talk about the whole abattoir, where five miles drive to whole town, you meet the abattoir, and then you know you are entering Ho. Then the talk of the asphaltic overlay in Ho town. That is, when you tell people something is happening in Ho, and they are outside where you say Ho, there's a lot of development. People don't see. That's the more reason we decided, you know, let's do this work for people to come. We saying the Ho is now, the roads have been asphalted. Come and walk on it yourself and see for yourself. And so those are some of the things. The airport has just started, and then where I think we are heading towards somewhere. So we need to show a piece.
Recently, there was a call from your region saying that prostitution has gone up because of lack of unemployment. There's also power crisis, which some of your people are facing, and some also crying because they're facing hardship in the economy. Could that explain why a lot of people did not turn up for this parade?
I don't want to admit that a lot of people did not turn up. You know, today is a market day. We intentionally decided to put this work on a market day, just to test the sincerity of the people. The fact that people don't turn up, I don't want to believe that.
But with the mention of some of these things, it doesn't really look good that the region is satisfied, because if you mention unemployment, you mention electricity, lack of electricity, you mention economic hardship, it doesn't look good for the region.
If there is anybody in the water region who is saying the lack of electricity, that person, I'm not speaking for the regional house of chiefs. I'm not speaking for the president of the regional house of chiefs. I'm not speaking for the regional minister, but I think that person should be telling a big lie. Water region has benefited adequately from electricity, self-help electrification, and then the rural electrification. And so there's nobody who can say that. If there's anybody who has ever said that, maybe that person will be doing something to himself.
Well, many thanks to you for your time. We appreciate your time on The Pulse.